In this video, I'm going to break down why the supplement industry is something that you really need to be a little bit more wary of. And the only reason that I'm saying this is we have so much power as consumers today to truly look into what is in a product. And in order to really understand how important it is to look into a product, we have to comprehend what goes on in the supplement industry and what also goes on with the FDA and what also goes on when it comes down to farming some of these animals, some of these plants that ultimately go into these supplements and into these products. So I'm gonna cover two things in this video. I'm gonna cover the supplement industry and the FDA a little bit, and then I'm gonna go into the science a little bit more. I'm gonna talk about GMOs, gonna talk about hormones, gonna talk about phytoestrogens, and a little bit of all that. So first off, let's talk about the supplement industry. The US Center for Disease Control has estimated that about half of the US population uses dietary supplements in one way or another. Now that could include multivitamins, that could include whey protein shakes, that could include fat burners, that could mean just about anything, but over half the population is ultimately using supplements of some kind. Now this ends up being about a $35 billion industry in the US alone. That's pretty darn powerful. And the ultimate amount of money that it's contributing to the economy ends up being about $121 billion. Now, by 2024, that's estimated to be about $278 billion. What does that tell us? Well, it tells us that it's a lot easier to bring a product to market these days. People can bring supplements to market very, very easily. With the advent of the internet and the advent of social media and the advent of direct response marketing, it makes it very, very easy for just about anyone to build a supplement, bring it to market, and see what happens. Well, the problem is that generally speaking, even at the number that it's at right now, dietary supplements end up resulting in over 100,000 calls to poison control centers just as it is. So what's gonna happen in 2024 when it's at 278 billion? That number is gonna probably triple. Now, it doesn't just happen because people are dying or getting sick from supplements. They're having adverse reactions because they don't always know what is in a product. And my case in point is that we can't always trust what is on a label. And that all has to do with the FDA. Now, I'm not bashing the FDA at all, okay? The FDA is a very busy organization, obviously. They have a lot of things to do. But when it comes down to supplements, they don't really regulate supplements. You see, there's nothing that a supplement company has to pass through when it ultimately launches a product. So I could conceivably start a product today, pay for it, manufacture it, bring it to market, and the FDA wouldn't have any regulation over it unless there was an issue, or unless someone got sick and actually raised a suit, unless there was an actual issue, which is pretty darn scary. So that's why it's so easy to bring a supplement to market and we don't always know what is in it. All it comes down to is the fact that if you put a disclaimer relieving the FDA of their liability, they're pretty much happy. So you put a simple little asterisk and you put a disclaimer on their bottle that says the FDA has not evaluated any of the claims that you're making, and you're kosher, at least until someone has an issue. That's a little bit scary. Now, there are some other little bureaucratic dangers that we have to deal with. And what I mean by bureaucratic dangers is the fact that the FDA is busy. They don't have time to regulate 50,000 different SKUs of supplements all the time, okay? That's gonna be very difficult. And to give you an example, the Canadian authorities found that popular fat burners actually ended up containing something known as BMPEA, which is a derivative of amphetamines. They were finding this in fat burners and other stimulant products. Well, here's the thing, Canadian authorities found that, not the FDA. Now, once the FDA caught wind of it, they investigated it a little bit more and they found that 9 of 21 of the most popular fat burners and stimulants ultimately contained BMPEA. Now, it doesn't mean that supplement companies are just totally bad people. It just means that sometimes they put pharmaceuticals in there to try to enhance the placebo effect of their product. If you were to take something that was a stimulant or take something that was a fat burner that was supposed to help you feel better, and they add a pharmaceutical to it, well, your perceived value or your perception of the product as far as its efficacy is going to be a lot better because you have a much more potent drug in there. But the problem is that this could affect you adversely. Okay, so now we've talked about how the supplement industry works and how the FDA works and how that's gonna be really, really scary, but let's talk about the animal side. Let's talk about the plant side, because quite honestly, it doesn't matter what supplement you're taking, it's probably gonna have some kind of plant derivative or some kind of animal derivative. Point is, when we pay attention to what I discussed earlier in this video about the labels, about all of that, then we have to think about how it applies to supplements that are a lot more food-oriented, you know, things like protein shakes and all that. We have to really be paying attention. You just have to learn how to read a label and make sure that you're getting grass-fed, make sure you're getting good quality, make sure you're getting locally sourced proteins whenever possible. Now, another thing that people will do is when it comes down to their proteins, like their whey proteins, they'll use whey protein concentrate. Now, the concentrate is a very low quality form. You want to look for a whey protein isolate. The other thing that we have to look at when we're looking at any kind of animal derivative, so especially proteins, especially collagen proteins, is going to be the antibiotic effect. Okay, we put a lot of antibiotics in our proteins these days. So cows, pigs, anything. They're going to be loaded with antibiotics to make sure that they can stay in, quite frankly, unsanitary environments and still survive, be able to produce food. Well, obviously, those antibiotics are going to trickle down to us, and that's going to kill off our gut biome. If you're trying to get in shape, you're trying to get healthy, it doesn't make sense to diminish your gut biome. There are studies that are actually linking antibiotics to killing off your gut biome. So when we consume them indirectly through low quality proteins, it can be very, very bad. Which leads me to GMOs, genetically modified organisms. Now, this is a little bit more in the plant world, but there are a lot of studies that are now starting to show that GMOs do affect the RNA. Now, RNA is sort of a subsidiary of the DNA in our body. So although there aren't studies that are showing GMOs directly make us sick right here, right now, there are studies that show that it affects our genes. It affects how our body rebuilds tissue. That's pretty scary. We also don't know exactly what is happening with these GMOs. We don't know what they're always spliced with because it isn't always disclosed. So it's best to go for organic whenever possible. Now, when it comes down to things like soy protein or soy isolates or anything like that, organic compounds are always going to be better simply because 99% of the world's soy is genetically modified and contains high amounts of phytoestrogens and xenoestrogens, which are going to make it so that you're very, very bloated, make it so that you're very uncomfortable, and cause a massive hormonal imbalance within your body. So the point of this is to look at the label and then do your research. You can't just trust what is on the label because it's going to be generalized and it's going to be hiding additional things. So if you look at companies like Antler Farms that are taking their products and actually disclosing exactly where everything is sourced and disclosing that it's organic and disclosing that it's non-GMO and disclosing that it's grass-fed when applicable, you know that there's a legitimate act behind it to make sure that you're getting the highest quality product. Now let's end this video with something realistic. If you're trying to absorb your product, you're trying to get the most out of it, you're gonna ultimately save money by utilizing more of the product because it's clean and absorbed within your body than you would by buying a cheaper product that has low quality ingredients and hormones that are ultimately gonna set you back. So at the end of the day, do your research, know what's in your product, and know that the FDA, quite frankly, does not have your back. You are your only advocate. As always, I will see you in the next video.